Macmillan Audio presents The Third Woman by Mark Burnell, read for you by Elizabeth Knowelden. The true religion of America has always been America. Norman Mailer. Most people are other people. Their thoughts are someone else's opinions, their lives a mimicry, their passions a quotation. Oscar Wilde. Early October. He loved the ritual. It was as essential to his enjoyment of the countryside as the open space or clean air. A final stroll around the property before bed, the last of a cigar to smoke, the glowing embers of a good cognac warming his stomach. His only regret was that he didn't come here often enough. Otto Heilmann stepped out of his dacha onto brittle grass, 5 below 0, he estimated, perhaps even 10. His guests had gone to bed. Their cars were parked beside the boat shed, a black Mercedes 4x4 with dark glass, and an Audi A8 with an auxiliary engine and armor plating. Frost had turned both windscreens opaque. Heilmann wandered to the edge of the lake, trailing clouds of breath and smoke. The silvery light of a 3/4 moon shone on the ice. He saw buttery pinpricks in the blackness of the far shore. 2 dachas, one belonging to a senior prosecutor from St. Petersburg, the other to a Finnish architect. There was no cloud, and only the faintest whisper of a breeze. Heilmann smoked for a while. As Bruno Manns, a Swiss travel consultant based in St. Petersburg, he felt a very long way from the grim years of the German Democratic Republic, a long way from Erich Mielke, his Stasi boss during those years, and a long way from Wolfersepp, the ubiquitous industrial-strength detergent that was the defining odor of the Honecker regime for millions of East Germans. Once smelled, never forgotten, a scar of memory. He tossed his soggy cigar stump onto the ice and continued his circuit. Along the lakeshore, past the creaking jetty, up towards the woodshed. Hello, Otto. A female voice. He thought he recognized it, except she was supposed to be in Copenhagen. But it was her face that emerged from the darkness of the birch forest. Heilmann clutched the coat over his chest. I hope you know what to do if I have a heart attack. Krista Jaspersen stared deep into his eyes and smiled. Don't worry, Otto. I know exactly what to do. He wasn't reassured. She was wearing thick felt boots, a great overcoat, and the sable hat he'd given her 2 nights ago at the Landskrona restaurant on top of the Nevsky Palace Hotel in St. Petersburg. He tried to recapture his breath. What are you doing, Krista? Waiting for you. Out here? I remembered your routine. An answer of sorts, Heilmann conceded, yet hardly adequate. You could have phoned to say you were coming, like normal people do. He glanced over one shoulder, then the other. How did you get here?
By car.
I mean, here.
The man at the gate let me through.
Just like that?
Just like that.
She looked the same. Long, fair hair, dark green eyes, a mouth of invitation. But she was radiating a difference that Heilmann couldn't quite identify. It's freezing, he said. Let's go inside.
You have guests.
They're asleep. I'm not staying, Otto. The mystery is why you're here at all. You should be in Copenhagen. Krista reached inside her coat and pulled out a gun. A Sig Sauer P226. Moonlight glittered on a silencer. There was no outrage. That surprised her. Heilmann had a notoriously fragile temper. Instead, after a digestive pause, he simply nodded glumly and said, Let me take a guess. You're not even Danish. She shook her head. Not really. No. Who are you? The seconds stretched as they stared at each other, eyes watering in the cold, neither prepared to look away.
The stupid thing is, I knew it, he murmured. In my head, I knew it, but I let my heart overrule and...
More likely it was another part of your anatomy.
You were too good to be true. That was my initial reaction to you.
I've been accused of many things, but never that. A deep breath deflated slowly.
So, what is it?
You'll never guess.
The ghosts of the past.
That doesn't narrow the field much, does it? Not after your glittering career with the Stasi. But no, it's not that. His surprise seemed genuine. He considered another option.
The S-75s.
Krista smiled.
I knew you'd say that.
The S-75 air defense missile was a relic of the Soviet era, prominent in conflicts from Vietnam to the Balkans. Hundreds of them had been transported from the nations of the Warsaw Pact to the Ukraine for decommissioning and dismantling. Many had vanished into thin air, leaving no trace, a feat made possible by the astonishing elasticity of the accounting practices at the Ukrainian Defense Ministry.
Scrapyard chunk, Heilman declared.
Maybe. But you know what they say about muck and brass. How much time have you spent in Kiev over the last decade?
I don't know. Plenty. What is your point, Krista?
Otto Heilman, store manager at the Ukraine hypermarket, flogging the decrepit remains of the Soviet arsenal to third world psychopaths. A lucrative business, judging by the way you live, Otto. And better than pulling fingernails out of old ladies in the damp cellars of Leipzig, I imagine. The gap in the military inventory from the Soviet era, how much would you say it's worth today?
I have no idea.
The figure I hear most often is $180 billion, but I've heard higher. Last year, the Ukraine spending budget was $10 billion. In terms of a trading environment, I'd say that left plenty of room for maneuver. What do you think?
Is that what this is about? Missing missiles?
200 of them.
They're museum pieces.
There's value in antiquity, Otto. Even in yours. Krista smiled coldly. Actually, that's not what this is about. But it's nice to know I was right about you. No, this is a private matter.
Between you and me?
Between you and your bank.
My bank?
You've overextended yourself, Otto.
So here you are, with a gun.
That's right.
That shit. I have business with a lot of banks. Which one?
Guderian Meyer. Hellman looked incredulous.
You work for them. I don't believe you.
You made a mistake in Zurich.
And you're making one here.
Your money's no longer any good.
What are you talking about?
Most bank managers send you a letter. Yours has sent me. Heilman snorted dismissively.
Very funny, but banks don't shoot people, so no more games, okay? Just tell me, why are you here?
Krista Jesperson raised the six-hour P226.
I've come to close your account, Otto. Permanently.
Day one. When she opened her eyes, the face beside her was a surprise. She'd expected to be alone in the bedroom of her crumbling apartment off Boulevard Ansbach. Instead, she found herself in a room with curtains, not shutters, a room overlooking Avenue Louis, not Rue Saint-Géry. Brussels, 6:40 on a bitter January morning. Outside, a tram grumbled on the street below. She'd always liked the sound of trams. Next to her, Roland was still asleep, half his head lost in the quicksand of a pillow. Stephanie pulled on his blue silk dressing gown, which was too big for her, and rolled up the sleeves. In the kitchen, she poured water into the kettle and switched it on. Gradually, she recalled a day that had started in Asia. She'd called Roland from the airport at Frankfurt while waiting for her connection to Brussels, and again when she'd touched down at Zaventem. Earlier, in Turkmenbashi, and then on the Lufthansa flight back from Ashgabat, she'd been aware of the familiar sensation, the seep of corruption that always followed the adrenaline rush. She'd needed Roland, because she couldn't be alone. His bathroom belonged in a hotel. Heated marble floor, marble sink, fluffy white towels folded over a ladder of hot chrome rails, a soap dish full of molten brown miniatures. Typical, really. A bathroom at home to remind him of the hotels he used abroad. Still, lack of imagination in a man was not always a disadvantage. She showered for 5 minutes. Stepping onto the white bath mat in front of the mirror, Stephanie saw Petra Ruter looking back at her. Her other self, the differences between them at that moment counting for nothing, though the body they shared now belonged more to Petra than Stephanie. In that sense, it was a barometer of identity. Where Petra favored muscular definition, Stephanie slipped happily into softness. She ran a hand over the stone ripple of her abdomen and looked into a pair of hard, dark eyes. Only her mouth appeared warm and inviting. There was nothing she could do about those generous lips. The rest of her looked cold and mean. When she was in this mood, even the slight bump on her nose, courtesy of two separate breaks, looked large and ugly. Worse was the cosmetic bullet wound through her left shoulder. In 48 hours, beneath an Indian Ocean sun, Stephanie knew she'd despise it. Petra's badge of honor was a reminder of the life she couldn't escape. She dressed in the crumpled clothes she'd scooped off Roland's sitting room floor, dark grey combat trousers with a neon pink stripe down each leg, two t-shirts beneath a Donna Karan jersey, and a pair of caterpillar boots. Toweling long, dark hair, she returned to the kitchen, made coffee, then took two mugs to the bedroom, setting one on Roland's bedside table. He began to stir. She drew the curtains. On Avenue Louise, the first hint of rush hour, headlights slicing through drizzle. From behind her came a muffled murmur. Marianne. Stephanie turned around.
You look a little crumpled.
Roland grinned, pleased at the description, then propped himself up on an elbow and patted the mattress.
Come back to bed. I've got to go. So have I. Now come back to bed. Exactly what kind of investment bank do you work for? The kind that understands a good worker is a happy worker.
The candle of temptation flickered briefly. Generally, the more attractive the man, the more cautious Stephanie was. In her experience, good-looking men tended to make lazy lovers. Not Roland, though.
Last night, he said, reaching for the mug, that was really something. If only you knew.
A surgical procedure to cut away tension. That was what it had been. There, on the floor of the entrance hall, tenderness cast aside as roughly as their clothes. Around 9, they'd gone out to eat at Mont Liban, a Lebanese place on Rue Blanche, a couple of minutes' walk away. By the time they'd returned to his apartment, her desire had been back, less frantic, but just as insistent, which was how her clothes had ended up on his sitting room floor. Strange to think of it now, like an out-of-body experience. Roland was staring at her through the steam rising from his coffee, his disappointment evident.
What are you thinking? She asked. That I went to bed with one person and woke up with another.
Stephanie said,
I know the feeling.
It's no longer raining when I step onto Avenue Louise. Winter blows shivers through the puddles and snaps twigs from the naked plane trees. Ahead, the rooftop Nikon and Maxell signs are backlit by a cavalry charge of dark cloud. Brussels. Bitter, grey, wet. And perfect. This city at the heart of the European Union is an ideal home for me. It's a city of bureaucrats. In other words, a city of transient people who shy from the spotlight and never have to account for their actions. People like me. In some respects, the city is an airport hub. When I'm here, there's always the feeling that I'm passing through,
that I'm a stranger in transit, even in my own bed. I had a proper home once. It didn't belong to me. It belonged to the man I loved, but it was mine nevertheless. It was the only place I've ever been able to be myself, and yet he never knew my name or what I did. With hindsight, civilian domesticity, Petra's professional life running in parallel to Stephanie's private life was an experiment that failed. I took every precaution to keep the two separate, to protect one from the other. But that's the truth about lies. You start with a small one, then need a larger one to conceal it. In the end, they swamp you. Which is exactly.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.